ask everyone to stand for a moment of reflection and the pledge of allegiance to the flag. Thank you. I pledge allegiance
to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
I forget from meeting to meeting that we are streaming this meeting. So I would like to introduce myself to the thousands of people that are watching our meeting. And I'm going to ask the board, including our brand new member, Pastor Fred Newville, to introduce themselves. I'm Tom Petway. I'm chairman of the board of the JEA. Fred?
Fred Newville.
Alan Howard.
Dolores Kessler, board member and secretary.
Jody Brooks, chief legal officer.
Paul McElroy, CEO.
Hussein Cumber, board member.
And Kelly Flanagan will not be with us today. And we have our arriving member. We're introducing ourselves to the thousands of people that are watching us on stream.
Ed Burr, board member.
Excellent. Very good. Everybody passed. We have our agenda. We have agendas in the back of the room. If everybody doesn't have one, please let me have a motion to adopt the agenda as submitted to
Second.
You all. Discussion? All in favor say aye.
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 Opposed, same sign. Thank you very much. I'd like to call on our CEO, Paul McElroy, for a safety briefing. Paul?
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Safety is a critical value at JEA. We start all meetings with a safety briefing to ensure that in case we did have an event, that everyone could exit the room in an orderly fashion. If we are called to leave the room in an evacuation, we will go to the stairwell to the left of the elevators as we came in. We will orderly walk down slowly, watching out for one another, the 19 flights of step, holding onto the guardrail. We will gather in the southeast corner of the empty lot, in the southeast corner of Church and Main Street. For security, Ted Hobson will call 911 and Mike Prost for in the event CPR is required. Other than that, we have to remind everyone to put their cell phones on silent, and that's our briefing. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you, Mr. McElroy. Any questions? I'd like to call on our Chief Legal Officer, Jody Brooks, for our Sunshine Law Public Record Statement.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Just a reminder that this is a duly noticed public meeting. Minutes are being taken, all in compliance with Florida Sunshine Law.
Thank you. Before I proceed with comments from the public, and we have two cards, I'd like to ask Ms. Kim Jowers to come forward, please. I have permission from our lawyer to pass all these signature requests that we have, and we can work while we're working.
Okay.
So I'm going to start these. Why don't we start these going that way? So sometime during the meeting, if you would sign all those papers and pass them to your fellow board member there, I would appreciate it. A lot of documents we need to have signed today. Ms. Jowers, welcome to the JEA board meeting.
Thank you.
Please proceed.
Hi, I'm Kim Jowers, and earlier this month, I sent a letter to the board members and senior executive management for JEA on behalf of USGBC Northeast Florida, and I'd just like to read a piece of that here so that it's on record, please. With the new year upon us, USGBC would like to express our desire for JEA to form in partnership with diverse stakeholders, a solar policy committee, and series of workshops with the objective of creating a comprehensive and forward-thinking solar energy program for our city. Jacksonville has a very capable, talented, and willing community of stakeholders in the green community that would make a great addition to your solar policy development team. You have a great deal of common ground with these experts who can work in concert with JEA executives in formulating a thoughtful, long-term plan and supporting policy. We are offering our assistance in order to facilitate a cooperative effort to include senior management at JEA and members of the green community in Jacksonville. We know there are solutions that can work for JEA, the solar industry in Jacksonville, and most importantly, Jacksonville as a whole. We sincerely wish to strengthen and diversify the energy industry and to encourage friendly alliances within the energy sector in Jacksonville. Everyone agrees that changes in policies concerning renewables like solar will be necessary moving forward. The ultimate objective of the committee and workshops is to ensure the creation of fair and reasonable policies that are in everyone's best interest. We would like to thank you in advance for committing to form and participate on this committee and providing our community with a well-developed policy to serve the residents of Jacksonville. Other utility companies look to you for leadership and direction and example, so we thank you for continuing to provide them with forward-thinking and well-thought-out policies and programs.
Thank you, Ms. Jowers, and I appreciate your earlier correspondence. Ms. Jowers, I, for one, am proud of the JEA's solar policy. I think we're making a good effort. And Mr. Wilking is also asked to speak on solar policy. And I'm asking our CEO right now to formulate a response, a couple-minute response.
Yes, sir.
To you and Mr. Wilking to see if we can get you somewhere close to where I think we are.
Thank you.
Thank you, Ms. Jowers, for being here today. Mr. Wilking, Pete Wilking. Doesn't seem fair that I know what you're going to talk about before you talk about
it. Oh, I know. Well, Happy New Year to you all.
Happy New Year to you. Yeah.
Put my glasses on here. Lower the mic a little bit. Forgive me for reading. I only have 3 minutes, so I got to get a lot of stuff in here. So, good afternoon. My name is Pete Wilking, president and founder of A1A Solar Contracting. As you may know, solar jobs in the U.S. increased by 25% in 2016, according to the Department of Energy's 2017 Energy and Employment Report released on Friday. In Florida, the public is overwhelmingly supportive of solar and renewable energy, as evidenced by the results of Amendments 1 and 4 that were on last year's Florida ballots, despite voter confusion on Amendment 1. The facts are irrefutable. Solar is growing. Since the presidential election, we're seeing record numbers of people interested in solar here locally. With the growth of solar, it is understandable that JEA has concerns. I also have concerns. So once again, we are attempting to work with JEA leadership to be heard and taken seriously in formulating an intelligent solar policy that can work for everyone now and in the future. Last year, JEA proposed changes to their solar policy that did not go over so well, as we all remember. Clearly, the decisions you make on this topic are highly impactful and have resonated in the community. Your decisions moving forward directly impacts jobs, health, quality of life, and will determine the future of clean energy in Jacksonville. The public shows very strong support for clean energy, and now energy storage technology has brought products that change everything, including the real possibility of grid-tifection going off-grid. A departure of this type eliminates all the shared benefits of distributed generation and is not something I support. Technology has rapidly changed energy and traditional utility business models. Solar is here whether you want it or not, but it is a good thing. We as a community want to work with JEA, and we've put together several policy recommendations that have no impact on the solar stakeholders, but give sizable savings and benefits to JEA and non-solar ratepayers. There needs to be a better two-way street here, and I'd like to think it can be done constructively and rationally. We have always agreed that the current net metering policy should evolve as the number of solar installations increase, and they have. We also agree that keeping the buyback rate at retail will not be logical at some point. There is an opportunity for JEA to capitalize with distributed generation. As you know, the USGBC has formally offered to serve as facilitator for a new solar policy. I've been asked to be on that committee, and I'm honored. And I believe you will be impressed and surprised as to how much better JEA's solar policy can be with our input. I have long viewed JEA not as a competitor, but as an energy alliance partner, And I still believe that there is no reason for the solar community to be at odds with JEA. The nature of energy and power distribution is changing before our eyes. We live in very exciting times. I ask you all on a personal and professional note to please embrace the USGBC's offer. JEA has nothing to lose and much to gain by taking this path. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Wilkin. I ask Mr. McElroy to respond directly to these two comments that we just received. He also has in his report an update, but Paul, why don't you, let's start with the response here, and we can continue it in your management report. Please, sir.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, and thank you to our guest speakers for coming in and sharing their views on this critical issue with respect to power generation in Northeast Florida and quite frankly within our country. We are in receipt of the email, and we do have plans to respond in writing, and certainly following up this meeting, we'll be drafting that and sending that off to the group. We participate in any number of national activities studying the flow of solar, both in terms of the technologies, the pricing, and really the regulatory and rate frameworks that have been discussed. So in terms of bringing information to a discussion, I think from the board's perspective, you have certainly utility resident experts that have dedicated full-time positions over the last number of years in evaluating this, what will be a critical component of our generation in the future. The vote, interesting, and would be interested in terms of, you know, future dialogue and perspective, in terms of the Amendment 1 statewide, 59.6% in our county, our service territory, did vote yes. Now, that did not reach the 60% level, and it was certainly well more than what the state average was on that. So as we look at solar, and it's not so much the pay of when, but it's the pace of change, we certainly have to be mindful of our other 449,000 customers. We will, and we have plans for very significant investment in solar, and the cost at the utility scale, and particularly the financial products that allow us to access solar at very, very low cost on a historical level are really coming to market. And I speak with the other utility CEOs in the state on a regular basis, in particular the investor owns, in terms of their plans. And we'll be watching that and potentially participating in a very large scale when we call universal solar, so all of our customers can participate and benefit from this emerging technology. Recognizing, you know, that we've got to move forward with dialogue, we have put on retainer an expert in this field that has worked with the our service territory environmental community over 20 years, has had a successful track record of bringing parties together, and is fully knowledgeable in terms of the transition. And we expect him to be, actually he was on board last week in terms of evaluating files on the issue of solar in particular. And so we'll work with the participants. We plan to reach out and have a series of meetings with the participants in terms of your group and others. We will listen. Certainly we will share our evaluations, and we will listen and evaluate your thoughts on this issue, and I think and hope we can come to terms to provide the board with a policy decision, which needs to be made. You know, we're looking at probably early this summer. And so that's my report, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you, sir. We'll have some time for discussion on this item later in the management report. And I appreciate the speakers as well. Moving along to 2B, I'd like to welcome Councilman Greg Anderson, our council liaison. Join us for a moment.
Thank you, sir.
Councilman.
Good afternoon thank to you. All of you. And on behalf of the City Council, I'd like to thank you for your service to our community. Congratulations to the new director. Director Newbolt on your recent appointment. We weren't too tough on you, the rules. Your bill 2016-764 regarding board meeting frequency continues to move its way through council. It's assigned to two committees, Rules and TEU. Your representative's been working with council to assist in this process, and I understand as a result of some of their meetings, there may be some minor language changes that align this with four of the other independent authority governance documents. So finally, I'd like to let you know that I've been briefed on the demand rate initiative, which we discussed today, and I look forward to hearing more about it. Thank you, Chairman.
Thank you, Councilman. We appreciate the time you share with us at JEA. You're a good advocate, and we appreciate your leadership. Thank you very much. Dr. Johnny Gaffney, Representative Liaison of the Office of the Mayor. Dr. Gaffney, nice to have you with us today, sir.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I don't have much to share today. The mayor just wanted me to make sure that I congratulate Pastor Newbill, the board member, on his successful election to the board. And other than that, I want to wish everybody a good year.
Thank you, Dr. Gaffney. Give the mayor our regards.
Yes, sir.
Mike Mullin's not with us today.
Correct.
The ex officio representative from Nassau County is not in attendance. Now I'd like to go to 2E, the J.D. Power Final Business Results, Richard Vento, interim chief customer officer of the J.D. Welcome, sir.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. So to frame the discussion, JEA received its final business results from J.D. Power last week, and those results are a result of two waves of surveys that take place. The first wave ended in June, and the second wave ended in November, clearly part of Hurricane Matthew. So we'll use that to frame the discussion. How about that? We know our results, and you'll see the results, but we don't know the reasons why, because that relies upon some in-depth study in terms of all the metrics that actually drive those values. So we'll be working through on the whys versus the results. Okay, next slide, please. So the slide shown on the left has our residential customer satisfaction index scores, and that hasn't changed since the last time you saw it. Although, if I have leave from the chair, I'd like to share that we've just received our residential results this morning, and I can give a brief highlight. Okay.
Please do.
Hot
off the press.
Hot off the press. We're very, very proud. Now, back up. We're still on residential. This report is, by the way, for business, and we received that last week. Now we just received our residential this week, and it's hot off the press. All right, so you can see the back up, please. One more. There you go. On the left-hand side, the residential. The last time it was reported, we were at 749, and that was a result of the first of four waves. Currently, at the second end of our second wave, we're now at 766. That also finished in the October-November timeframe. That wave was done in October-November timeframe, which was during the middle of the hurricane, which is interesting. We are now, at this point, at the halfway point, 10 points away from being number one nationwide. We're ranked 12th in the nation, and we are first quartile in every one of our drivers of satisfaction. So we look forward to those results in detail and looking what's going to take to get us to the top. That was residential. Now, on the right-hand side, this is the results that came back last week, which are the business results. These are final results through 16. And you can see that we've continued our year-over-year performance, increased in the customer satisfaction, maintaining a four-year trend of being first quartile. We're currently 12th out of 86 in the nationwide and 3 out of 6 in Florida, with FP&L and Gulf above us. Next slide, please. Drilling deeper, the overall customer satisfaction index is made up of six what we call drivers of satisfaction. Those are the items that are listed on the left. And we track our scores year over year, and you can see that in each and every driver of satisfaction, we've continued with an improvement, a double-digit improvement from year to year. Next slide, please. So overall, what this slide shows, on the right-hand side is that we are currently, for business customer satisfaction, we are first quartile in all of our drivers of customer satisfaction, with the exception of billing and payment. That's the only one that we're not currently in the business side. And we'll continue to dig into the reasons why to make sure that moves into first quartile. Next slide, please. Last slide shows the relative ranking of JEA to the nationwide, to the industry. From left to right, the dark green is top quartile ranking, and the far right in red is bottom quartile or fourth quartile. As you can see, JEA sits solidly in the first quartile ranking. Of note is we received the J.D. Power Trophy for being number one last year. And our score last year was 754. And if you follow down, it's 754 is now under second quartile, the bottom third of second quartile. That would be the South Carolina Electric and Gas. So the industry continues to move substantially, improving customer experience and improving customer satisfaction. So a lot of work to be done to maintain our standing, and a lot of additional work to be done to bring us from solid in first quartile to what we'd like to be as the top decile. And that concludes my report, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you, Richard. Any questions or comments? Paul, you want to comment on the J.D. Power, or you want to save that for the end?
I'll save that for the end, Mr. Chairman. Thank you.
We have a glowing response of appreciation for you and your fellow associates. Thank you very much. We're excited about the report. Board members, we need approval of the consent agenda, item 3. May I have a motion and a second, please?
So moved.
Second. Any discussion? Anybody want to pull anything off of the consent agenda? All in favor say aye.
Aye.
The consent agenda. Opposed, like sign. Thank you. We will move to 3B1 and ask Melissa Dyer to join us. Hi, Melissa.
Good afternoon.
Quarterly financial report. Welcome.
Thank you. I am reporting on the first quarter of financial results for the year. And I'll report out on metrics, sales trends, and an early look at financial results. Although a note for the board members who are reviewing this information, the first quarter of our fiscal year tends to be moderate in terms of irrigation needs and moderate in terms of weather. And so this is just a first early look at a full year of projected financial results based on those that data. From a financial metrics perspective, we are projecting healthy debt service coverage through the full fiscal year in the electric system with the 265 days of liquidity at year end, 153 of which are cash. That is a decrease in cash position over the end of last year, primarily related to withdrawals from the fuel fund. Our debt to asset ratio projection for year end is 62%, which continues to show that great improvement year over year in debt outstanding. A similar story in the water and sewer system, projecting 2.5 times debt service coverage, 309 days of liquidity, of which 197 are cash, and 50% debt to asset ratio, which is a very significant milestone for the balance sheet of the water and sewer system. From a sales perspective, the first quarter of this year, the weather's been very mild, and we see that reflected in the overall sales for the year. We're down almost 3% versus last year, and last year was also a very mild year. So you see that continued trend in terms of downward sales for this first part of the year. What's interesting to note about the sales breakdown is on the bottom right-hand side of this page, you see the breakdown in terms of what's happened by customer class. So we are actually up on residential sales, and the primary driver for that is the addition of accounts. We're growing at almost 2% a year, and so for per account, we're not seeing any significant change in usage, but we are growing in terms of number of accounts. That is offset by a reduction in commercial and industrial sales, and then much larger reductions in interruptible and wholesale. The largest reduction there is our wholesale customer at a FPU, and that's due to one of their cogen facilities coming online, and therefore they're taking significantly less power from JEA. In terms of financial results, what that translates into is an expected total revenue coming in about $25 million under our budget for the year, again, driven by those lower sales. On the expense side, we are projecting net revenues about $48 million over budget, driven by some changes in the expense side versus budget. Fuel expenses projected to come in about $458 million. You do see a pretty big increase in fuel expense versus both last year and versus our budget, driven by a run-up in fuel prices on the solid fuel side. We're seeing higher coal and higher pet coke prices that are driving some of that fuel expense up for the year. In O&M, we're projecting $207 million versus last year. Much of that increase is driven by storm-related expenses due to Hurricane Matthew. On the capital side, we are projecting at this point to come in basically right on last year and very similar to our budget for the year. So capital forecast looks good in the electric system. Debt service is pretty substantially higher, but that builds in the rate restructuring plan that was approved by the board last month. So that assumes we're going to do the refinancing and load some additional principal into this year, which has resulted in higher debt service for the year. In the water and sewer system, again, some pretty interesting trends on sales, this one going the other direction. We are up for the year 7% year over year in water sales, which is a pretty substantial increase. That's driven by residential sales, which is up 6.4% versus last year. A little bit of difference in commercial and industrial, and then a big increase in irrigation, which is great, which is really good news. I'll note that even with those the significant year-over-year increase, we're still well below our peaks that we experienced back in 2007. In terms of drivers, if you just look at aggregate precipitation data, there's not an obvious reason for that increase, but if you look at the pattern of precipitation, that's where we think the drivers of this are coming from. Essentially, we got a ton of rain during Hurricane Matthew and very little since, and so that's driven some of that water consumption, especially on the residential side. In terms of financial results, they track what you would expect based on the sales results. Total revenue coming in over budget by about $7 million is the projection, and net revenue about $11 million over budget. Our capital expenditures are one of the big takeaways from the financial results slide on the water and sewer side. We are projecting $205 million of CapEx in water and sewer, which is substantially higher than in previous years. Those higher sales will help support that level of capital for this year without the issuance of debt. And debt service is tracking versus budget pretty well. The debt and debt-to-asset ratio slide is basically unchanged since last time we looked at it. There's a significant reduction in debt versus our peaks and actually getting pretty close to our peer ratio and debt-to-asset ratio on the water and sewer side. We still have a ways to go on the electric side from that perspective. Combined debt outstanding, this is a look at our weighted average interest rates in across our entire debt portfolio. No material movement since last time we reported out on this, although I'll note the front end of the interest rate curve has come up substantially over the last year. And at this point, market consensus is that there'll be more Fed moves through the end of the calendar year, which will continue to drive up the cost of that short-term debt by between 50 and 75 basis points is market consensus now. On that front. I do want to just note there's a lot of discussion politically now about tax reform. And one of the potential implications for us in the tax reform discussion has to do with the elimination of tax-exempt financing for municipal entities. For us, the impact would be to essentially drive up the cost of our debt portfolio with the elimination of that tax exemption. It's an important issue to us. It's one that we continue to advocate for through APPA and LPPC and other organizations that that provide that avenue, and it's one that we'll continue to watch very closely. In terms of risk analysis in our debt portfolio, no material changes in the risk analysis associated with either our liquidity or direct purchase bond providers or the interest rate swap providers. Counterparty credit seems to be very stable over the last several years in the portfolio. And from an investments perspective, we're seeing, again, that run-up on the short end of the yield curve that's on the left-hand side of this page. You can see compared to a year ago, it's pretty substantially higher. The good news on the right-hand side of the page is that we're getting a little bit more yield in our investment portfolio, which has provided some relief there. It's an interesting world when you're happy about slightly over 1%, but we are happy. And from a rates perspective, we have one utility on the electric side that did jump over us last month, so we've pushed down in the rates comparison on the electric side. In water and sewer, we continue to be well below the median in terms of rates. Mr. Chairman, if I could go off script, I do have some information to share that we received on Friday about the outcome of our credit ratings from our meetings in December. And hopefully the board members have this in front of you. We received reports from all three rating agencies. We received reports from S&P, Moody's, and Fitch regarding the credit ratings in the electric system. Our water and sewer system credit ratings will likely come about in the middle of the calendar year. In the electric system, I am happy to report that Moody's affirmed our AA2 credit rating, that Fitch affirmed our AA flat credit rating. Standard & Poor's had the credit rating that was an outlier. They were one notch below our other two credit ratings, and they have been for a number of years at AA minus. S&P, as of Friday afternoon, put us on positive outlook. Which is great news and a great outcome from that meeting. I'd like to share just a few quotes from those reports that I think are reflective of the work that was done at that meeting, and in particular by the attendance of the chairman of our board, our mayor, and our city council president. So I'm reading from the Moody's report now. Moody's rating outlook for JEA's electric system, SJRPP, and bulk power system revenue bonds is stable, as we expect management to focus its considerable strengths on running this competitive enterprise. The outlook also incorporates the anticipated benefits of the latest rate increase and the near-term plans for debt refunding, along with the latest risks associated with JEA's participation in the take-or-pay obligation with MEAG Power for output from the Vogtle nuclear expansion project. And one thing I'd like to note, there in December, Toshiba, who's the financial guarantor of that Vogtle project, was downgraded primarily due to cost news related to its nuclear business. And each of the credit ratings that we'll talk about in the reports we'll talk about incorporate that news and that information into their analysis. Later in the report, they say, we view a new city contribution agreement between JEA and Jacksonville and the pension reform underway in Jacksonville as credit-positive developments for JEA because they establish a degree of certainty that the city will not be unduly relying on JEA going forward to support the city's financial needs. Moody's has observed that even as the board membership has evolved over time, it maintains a long history of being proactive rather than reactive, with a focus on maintaining financial performance consistent with objectives. So there's some nice comments from Moody's in terms of the credit analysis. S&P echoes some similar sentiments. They say, the current business profile reflects JEA's rate-setting autonomy, a solid service area, and customer profile, and a diversified power portfolio tempered by a significant carbon footprint and exposure to nuclear construction cost overruns and delays. And then they go on to say later, we could raise the rating in the next 2 years if JEA is able to maintain the financial metrics consistent with projections while construction of the Vogtle nuclear units proceeds without further significant delay or disruption. So they've really laid the foundation to be able to give us a credit rating upgrade, hopefully, in the very near future. And that is the end of my financial report.
Thank you. Ms. Dykes, any questions or comments?
Mr. Chairman? Melissa, I had one question on slide 6 of your report, the JEA water and sewer system, specifically on the capital expenditures. Could you give us an explanation on the 40% increase in CapEx? Is that storm-related or long-term plan?
It's not. It's really consistent with our long-term plan. In fact, very little of that is storm-related. It's a combination of expansion needs that are due to growth within certain geographic pockets of the service territory. So there's actually some expansion dollars attached to that, along with some infrastructure upgrades that have been in the plans.
Mr. Chairman, follow up. Any storm repair CapEx in the budget?
You'll see some in the actuals. In terms of the financial reflection of the storm, it's, we budget, we have a budget line item associated for, with storm expenses. That budget then is transferred out to be able to cover storm expenses as needed as a result of the storm. So you'll primarily see slightly higher capital in both systems related to storm repairs, to the extent those repairs qualify for capital treatment. The rest of the expenses will show up in the O&M expenses.
Thank you.
Other questions? Thank you, Melissa.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
That was very good news on the, on our ratings, just in case everybody wants to hear it one more time. Double A neutral from Standard & Poor's, double A neutral to double A positive. Moody's was double A two to double A two, and Fitch was double A, double A. Mm-hmm. I think you should be very proud of that. Thank you for your good work.
Thank you.
Yeah. All right. Ike Brost, Electric System Generating Planning and Discussion. How to see you, Mike? Nice to see you, sir.
Important topic. And Melissa's actually got the first two slides on our presentation. You ready?
Yes. I wanted to share with the with board members this morning, and there should be a handout that has these slides with it. I don't believe it's in your board package itself. There's a separate handout. The first couple of slides are a summary of information that's published by EIA each January, where they took they do a long-term outlook and long-term view of the sector out through 2040, and make some projections for what the energy sector looks like in the United States. On the left-hand side of the page, you'll see by demand sector, they call it. So we've got it by customer class here. Residential, commercial, industrial, and transportation. And what that change looks like between 1990, 2016, and 2040. On the right-hand side, you see the aggregate growth projections for the industry as a whole out through 2040. And as you can see on both charts, growth is pretty anemic out through 2040. They are projecting a positive growth rate now out through 2040, but it's sort of barely positive. It's just under 1%. On the left-hand side of the page, though, as you see how that breaks down, one thing that we're monitoring very closely is the blue bars on the page, which are the direct use. And much of that growth is taken up by direct use, which is essentially distributed generation. So it's on-site generation for each of those customer classes. This lends some credibility to our internal projections, where we continue to forecast essentially flat sales for the foreseeable future, and we make our planning decisions accordingly. On the next page, you see how this breaks down in terms of fuel mix for electric generation according to EIA's projections. And this year, they did it two different ways. They, on the left-hand side of the page, they've got their reference case, which is essentially the base case for their model. On the right-hand side, they modeled what that would look like if there were no clean power plan. And so somewhat intuitively, on the left-hand side of the page, you see a pretty significant runoff in coal generation. The balance of that is made up by a combination of natural gas and renewables. And renewables are wind, solar, and actually include hydro in the EIA's projections. On the right-hand side of the page, with no clean power plan, there's just a much less significant runoff in coal. The balance of the growth is again made up by natural gas and renewables. In both scenarios, it's interesting to note nuclear remains relatively flat out through 2040.
So from a JEA system perspective, what does that look like? This is a chart we put together a couple of years ago, kind of conceptual, aspirational. There's not a lot of numbers on it, but it was in response to the now outgoing EPA's Clean Power Plan. This is basically the impact on our fleet, our generation fleet. As I believe you're aware, the Clean Power Plan pretty aggressively goes after CO2 as a pollutant, and it regulates the output of new generation, but also existing fleet, somewhat unprecedented in that sense. It would require, over about a 10-year time frame, the retirement of all of our solid fuel units. It's five units at three plants. It's about 1,800 megawatts of capacity. And virtually all of that would be going out prematurely from, they've got life left in them, so we're retiring them early. And there's a financial impact to that, and then we've got to build new to replace it. So the green triangle in the upper right-hand corner would be, what would we do to replace 1,800 megawatts of solid fuel? Would be a combination of things. It's not one-size-fits-all solution or plan. Some would be demand sides. Customer side of the meter would be great for our business if the customer could manage their demand down, and that's one of the objectives behind our new demand rate. That's good for business if the, we're not talking about energy per se, we're talking about the demand, getting that down, and that's customer demand management. Energy efficiency improvements help, and customer, as Melissa had just mentioned, the distributed generation, the customer-owned generation behind the meter, rooftop solar, and any other way that people can make electricity. So we have demand-side response to make up the loss. A lot of it will come from the supply side, and a lot of that is probably going to be natural gas combined cycle, which is risky from a diversity perspective. It's risky not in the short term, but look out 10, 15, 20 years. It's risky from a supply chain perspective, availability, cost. So the blue box at the bottom is our existing gas assets that we're going to keep. So we're going to replace some of the solid fuel with more gas assets. It just puts more eggs in one basket, so to speak. But that will be part of our plan forward, and it's certainly where the industry is heading anyway. You then supplement that with some nuclear. We have 206 megawatts coming from Vogtle. Nuclear has its pluses and minuses, but one of the pluses is it's zero CO2. And then you've got renewable utility scale, our side of the meter, so to speak, utility scale renewables, which could include biomass, landfill gas, a variety of solutions there. So that's, at a high level, conceptually, the plan forward. Now, of course, we had the election back in November, and we've got Friday's a big day, and you know, the question will be moving forward, what do we expect to see? A lot of that was predicated on the previous administration. We can expect to see pretty much the same thing, but probably on a longer add 10 or 15 or 20 years, and time will tell. We don't have a whole lot of certainty right now in terms of the future energy policy for the new administration, but probably a continued shift towards more renewable, maybe more nuclear, certainly more gas combined cycle, and nobody's building a new solid fuel plant. So as our existing assets approach end of life, they'll retire. The adverse impact we had on the Clean Power Plan was forcing them out sooner. So this is a summary of today. The table on the right is our existing generation capacity, 3,408 megawatts, about half and half gas versus solid fuel. The little table at the bottom shows changes in the future. This year and next year, we're going to add over 36 megawatts of universal utility scale solar PV. We've also got 200 megawatts coming from Vogtle in the 2019-2020 timeframe. And for 30 years of commercial operation at SGRPP, we've been selling FPL 383 megawatts of our capacity, a long-term power sale that was put in place early on. That will end in 2019. So what that means for us, today we're about 400 megawatts long on capacity. We've got more capacity in the fleet than we really need by 400. With these changes that'll come in 2019-2020, we'll be 1,000 megawatts long. So the question becomes, what do you retire at what time frame? Because clearly we need to increase the efficiency of the fleet, we need to lower cost, there will be retirements. We're assuming flat, no growth. So that will be the activity for our team for the next several years, certainly, and we're watching what's going on in Washington. We're watching the market. We're watching the industry. Price of fuel is important. I'll just close by saying our industry produces an IRP from time to time, Integrated Resource Plan. It looks out several decades and comes up with the answer of what's the best approach to meeting demand at the lowest possible cost and while meeting environmental goals and regs. So that's simply what we're talking about here, is looking out into the future, taking everything we know and some assumptions about what we don't know for certainty into account, and putting together the lowest cost solution for our customers for the next decade. Usually you're in a growth mode, and usually you're growing capacity. It's somewhat unusual that we're long, and we'll be contracting, we'll be retiring units without adding anything new. Questions?
Any questions? Mike? Thank you. Hussein? Excuse me.
Does this take into account, Mike, the effects of if the pilot program that we were going to do actually goes into full implementation, or does that put us more than 1,000 megawatts long?
The demand rate pilot, this does not factor in the demand rate pilot. That will be one of the key assumptions we look at moving forward. It will be factored in, but we didn't attempt to factor that in here.
Other comments, questions?
Maybe just three comments, Mr. Chairman, Board.
Mr. McElroy.
Follow up on the, I think Mr. Bross pointed out a very important philosophy and really policy that JEA has operated under for decades in its generation planning. And that is that when we look at the next generation technology or investment, it is done solely on the basis of the lowest possible NPV cost, taking into account best available technology that's tried and true and tested and commercially feasible in the marketplace. So as we look forward, that's a big policy decision going forward. That is a rock bed and foundational issue of our generation planning and our generation investments over the last decades. On page four, the transition in terms of rationalizing solid fuel, just a final observation on that, that if we look at as we grow on the green portion, investments in the future, that really those investments are zero carbon. On the demand side, that's zero CO2 because it's reducing demand.
Right.
We're not creating anything. On the supply side, we have natural gas combined cycle, and initially that investment is zero carbon as well because we're just dealing with the waste heat that is already being generated. The second step will be 1/2 carbon intensity of a coal or solid fuel facility. And then you get to nuclear and the other renewables are zero carbon in CO2. So a lot of this as we transition forward in terms of as we think about things prospectively and irrespective of the changes in Washington, we're going to be moving in this direction over the next period of time anyway, but it still will be based upon the core tenet of the lowest possible NPV cost with best available technology. And then just the final point, and I find this instructional and a little bit on page three, we showed the volume of electricity in billion kilowatt hours. But when we closed out 16, natural gas and coal represented about 65% of the electricity generated in this country. And so we can debate whether that's 32 and 33% or 30 and 35, but 65%. 20% is nuclear. So that's 85% of the electricity generated in the United States is either coal, natural gas, or nuclear. 8% is hydro, and hydro are legacy assets that have been in existence for the most part for many decades. And so that gets you to 92-93%. 7% is the rest of the basket of renewables in terms of solar and wind. And I think those are important in terms of the context going forward, but when we look at the context today, I think it's really important to look at the total basket of electric production capability and actually the production of electricity in our country today. So 65% gas and coal, and there is a transition there going between coal and gas, and a lot of that is economics driving that. 20% is that base nuclear, which is expected to stay there over the next four decades. Hydro at 8, and 7% is the renewable, the investment made up of solar, wind, biomass, and other technologies. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thanks.
Melissa, would you please bring us a discussion on the documentation of the water and sewer discount?
Got it.
All public hearing.
All public hearing.
Yes.
Although if you want to throw me a discount.
I'll take that one as homework.
All right, we're on B3. We want to discuss the recommendation to call a public hearing to modify the electric tariff documentation and the water and sewer rate discount. Melissa.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I am excited to be presenting this today. I'll let the board know this is the culmination of about 18 months of work by staff at JEA across the whole organization. It's really been such a tremendous cross-functional effort that's resulted in this recommendation for the board to consider calling a rate hearing. This is our demand rate pilot program. This is a program that initially we're asking to pilot for up to 150 customers through the end of this calendar year. And it's a program that changes the way that we bill customers. From a customer's perspective, the benefit for them is greater control. By controlling how and when they use energy, and essentially having their appliances take turns operating, they can exercise great control over their bill. To the extent customers make small behavior changes, but in a big way, in aggregate, that can influence some of the things we were just talking about in terms of the generation planning discussion. If our peaks get lower, that's essentially less generation capacity that we need to maintain, which results in lower costs for all of our customers and our community. So it's a really exciting pilot program. And of course, the cheapest megawatt is the one that we don't have to build. And this will help us to get to that outcome. The proposed pilot will initially be conducted in two phases. As I mentioned, the first phase is the one we're asking for the board to consider today, which is limited to 150 participants. And what we're looking for in this pilot is people who will participate with us essentially on a two-way street. So we have created tools and information for customers to understand the program itself, understand how they'll be billed, and understand how they can then control the ultimate outcome in terms of their electricity bill. But we're looking for those same customers to provide us with feedback so we can make those tools better as we look toward a larger pilot program as part of phase two. Phase two is where we'll be looking for statistically significant data. So we need a larger customer sample size of up to 2,000 participants to come on board with us and be billed under this new demand rate. And again, look at behavior changes as a class so that we can then forecast those behavior changes to Mr. Cumber's question earlier to the system as a whole. The program that's being rolled out, that's being proposed today, is the result of lots of customer research that's gone into how we construct the program and how we actually create and bill customers. The first thing we did was set up focus groups, and we looked at four different rate design and essentially collected directional information from those focus groups. And the outcome and the data from those focus groups is pretty interesting. We followed the focus groups with a quantitative survey to provide us with some actionable results that we could use then to set up both the rate and the communications. And then the feedback was used to determine the most preferred rate and communication channels for customers. And that was used to create specific customer messages around the rate. The feedback essentially validated the entire customer journey, starting from the understanding the what's in it for me from a customer all the way down to a customer providing feedback back to the utility. And using that education allowed us to create tools that we hope will be helpful for customers, both in understanding the rate and in controlling their bills. I do have a video I'd like to share that's an example of the type of communication that we've put together for customers. So if I could get that video started, that'd be great.
Today, we all need energy to keep us cool, dry our clothes, cook our food, and heat our water. But when and how we do those things varies by individual. Most of us don't spend a lot of time thinking about how much electricity it takes to run our appliances or what time we turn them on. Nor do we consider that everyone using multiple appliances at the same time creates a peak demand on the energy grid, which increases costs for everyone. That's why JEA and other power companies are creating price plans to better match what it really costs to serve different customers. In the end, everyone pays for what they really use. On JEA's current electric rate plan, most of your bill is based only on the amount of energy you use and the fuel required to generate that energy. Even though your bill isn't based on the amount of demand you place on the electric system when you turn multiple appliances on at the same time, they still create peaks and valleys in your energy supply needs, also known as your energy demand. Utilities are required by law to maintain enough energy supply to meet the highest peak demand of its customers all the time. Up until now, most energy companies, including JEA, rolled that cost into the energy charge. It was sort of a one-size-fits-all approach. To make things more equitable, JEA is introducing JEA Smart Savings. With this new plan, your bill will not include the energy charge as before. Instead, it will be based on two things: peak demand and fuel. You pay for your peak demand and the cost of the fuel to make the electricity you use. That gives you more control, which can result in more savings. But the key to keeping those savings is trimming your peak demand, especially during the electric system's peak hours. So what is peak demand? It might help to think about electricity like the internet service you need to stream a movie in your home. When just one device is streaming, everything works just fine. But if two or three people start watching different movies on different devices at the same time, they've created a peak demand. Peak demand costs utilities more because they put more strain on the grid. That's the network of power plants, lines, and other equipment that keeps your electricity flowing. So to reduce your peaks and save money, think about your appliances, say an electric range and a dishwasher. Make them take turns instead of running them at the same time. And remember, reducing your peak demand matters most during the electric system's peak hours, noon to 7 p.m. weekdays, April through October, and 6 to 9 a.m. weekday mornings, November to March. Holidays and weekends are excluded from peak hour charges. Peak hours are also the time to avoid running electric dryers, which are big energy hogs. Now that you know these are the most expensive times to run multiple appliances, you can save by avoiding these times. And the way to save the most is to make your appliances take turns all the time, to keep your peak demand low all the time. Learn more about JEA Smart Savings at jea.com/smartsavings.
The details for the rate are on page 6. What I'll just touch on, though, is the way that our customers pay their bill today. They pay based on the amount of kilowatt hours that are used every month. That was the one-size-fits-all that was referenced in the video. And by the way, before I forget, that special thanks to the retired Times Union cartoonist who helped us with the creation of that video. So we bill based on the amount of kilowatt hours that are consumed each month, but what a customer actually costs the system is based on the maximum amount of energy that customer is using at any given point in time. So if you go home and it's a hot day and you fire up your air conditioner and you turn on the oven and you turn on the stove and you turn on your dryer, that moment in time where you've got all those appliances on simultaneously is what we have to build the grid for, and that's essentially what you cost the system. So this rate is a way to better wed up what customers pay with the amount that they actually end up costing the system. And by making small behavior changes, our customers can come together to ultimately make everything cost less for our whole community. It sounds like a very different way to bill, and it is. There's a utility that we talked to pretty recently in Black Hills, South Dakota, though, that shared a story with us that they've had a residential demand rate for years. And they said one of the things they thought was interesting is it becomes very culturally ingrained. So someone had a story about being home with his mother, and his mother yelled at him for turning on the clothes dryer while they were cooking dinner. So people understand it as they start to get used to it over time. The highest peak for the month is calculated at $3.75 a kilowatt. That's in addition to, for billing purposes, it'll be a second charge associated with your peak demand during peak hours, which is $4.90 per kilowatt. And so there's an example bill on the bottom right of what that looks like. And this is actually a real customer's usage for a month. where this customer had 8 kilowatts during non-peak demand hours and 7 kilowatts during peak hours. And you can see how that breaks down in terms of the total bill for that customer at $125 a month. Interestingly, this bill under our previous rate was about $150. And so there will be higher and lower bills as a result of the demand rate. This is just one example where that different billing results in that different bill. From a timeline perspective, we are requesting that the board call for a rate hearing this month. The rate hearing would then occur next month, subject to the board's approval. Once it's approved, then we would propose to run the pilot for this first 150 customer phase through the end of this calendar year. That will allow us to gather enough feedback and data from those customers and gather enough usage data from those customers to be able to be better educated and provide better tools for phase two, which is our larger pilot phase, which we propose to run through the 2018 calendar year. In addition to the tariff changes associated with the pilot program, there are some administrative changes that we'd also like to include in the rate hearing for next month. As part of the board package next month, we will include a red line of the electric system tariff so you can see the actual language changes associated with each of these administrative changes. And that's my presentation, Mr. Chairman.
Let's thank you very much, Melissa. Just keep your seat, if you would. I'm going to see if I can get a motion, and we'll get some discussion. We have a motion and a second discussion. Discussion?
That's a great pilot.
That's a great pilot.
Yeah.
I like it.
Mr. Chairman, I have a suggestion. Howard. I like the example of the bill in the bottom right, but it would make, if I were a consumer, it would make more sense to me if there was a line item say, you save this much over what your bill would have been. Or maybe it says you pay more because you're running your dryer and your oven at the same time. I don't know. But I think that may help customer acceptance. You probably already thought of that.
Thank you for the suggestion.
Melissa, this is one of those ideas I wish I'd have thought of. It's kind of,
you get credit, Chairman.
Your tenure.
Hey, so why are we doing this? To the point, why is it going to take so long? I mean, you're talking about a pilot in 2018. I mean, I know I'm impatient, but I mean, that sounds ridiculous.
For what it's worth, I'm also impatient. The reality is, for us to be able to roll this out to our customers, there's some very big systems changes that have to happen behind the scenes. The first has to do with how we manage data. Right now, our current data management system isn't large enough to be able to accommodate the volume of data that we would get from rolling this out to 450,000 customers. It can handle 2,000. It can't handle 450,000. And so that's a multi-year project to be able to just upgrade the data system on the back end. Also, to participate in this program, customers have to have two-way meters installed, and not all of our customers have those today. So we'll be continuing to roll out the meter changeout program while we're running the pilot program, so we'll be better positioned to be able to roll it out as we get through the pilot phase. But there's some kind of long poles in the tent, so to speak, on a rollout to all customers, and those are the two major ones.
So would we take advantage of something that's out there that we, or do we start from scratch? I mean, is there a way to jump start with best practice somewhere? Somebody's doing this successfully, I would assume.
There are utilities that are doing it successfully. I think for us, we'll leverage all the expertise and all the best practices we can. I think there's just some things that take a while to implement. Unfortunately, okay. Those two are the two.
Gotcha. Any other discussion? Mr. Cumber.
Melissa, I think this is great. I know we've been talking about it for a couple of years now. I'm just trying to think about it from a customer perspective. So you opt into this, you're part of the pilot. How is that, just so I'm clear, so is the charge just based on time of day or even number of devices in the sense of, you know, what I'd love to see us eventually get to, right, is almost like a JEA app on your phone, right, where, you know, as houses become smart, you have the ability to kind of control what's going on in your house by your app that allows you to really take advantage of this because, you know, there's what, 2, 4, 8 of us sitting at the table. You know, my guess is some of us, and I will raise my hand and say I'm one of them, has their air conditioner or heater running right now as we're sitting at this table because when they walked out the door this morning, I forgot to hit a button. it'd be great, you know, I can do that through a Honeywell app and take care of it. But then I got to have an app for my air conditioner. I need to have an app for my water heater. I need to have an app for every device in the house. You know, I'd love to be able to see as we move towards implementation of this, if there's a way for JEA to become that intel inside, right? That we become the enabler of people being able to really take control of when their, you know, devices at home are being used and not at home. I don't know if that's technologically not possible, or if there's a way to do that, and start thinking about how you overlay that into what we're trying to do here. Because the more visibility we give customers as to what's going on in their house, the better we can change behavior. I mean, I think the challenge we have is people don't think in kilowatts, right? People think in dollars. So if you're, you know, I think about this from a transportation standpoint. I know whether to take the toll road or not because I know how much it's going to cost me. I don't know what a kilowatt in my mind kind of translates that to. And when you turn on a washer, a dryer, an oven, I have no concept of what that means from a kilowatt hour perspective.
We are. We have some tools that we're looking at in connection with this pilot program, and that's one of the exciting things about running a relatively small pilot, is it does create some flexibility to really take a hard look at these tools. We have an RFP out currently on the street now for tools that will enable customers to better manage their demand. And so that gets to some of the things that you've asked about. We have, perhaps more basically, we're creating a tool for our website that lets you go on and essentially have a mock house where you can select and deselect certain appliances to really give you a much better idea of how selecting those or turning on those appliances will impact your demand, and conversely how turning them off will impact your demand, and give you that visibility to manage your bill. So that's more of a generic and basic tool that could apply to all customers, but it's one to give you a much better sense for your air conditioner is about, you know, 10 times the electricity use of your washing machine. It gives you kind of orders of magnitude in terms of appliance usage. So there's some things we're exploring to be able to allow customers to do that, to be much smarter about understanding what in their home is using how much energy and when, and how they can then better control that, either through a JEA offered tool or through a third party tool that we can connect them with.
You know, I would comment on that the technology is changing very rapidly in terms of how you measure, what device you use, and really what technology. So we're watching that really closely. It's a great idea and concept, but if we can partner with others, we will. But ultimately, that's the goal, allowing people the ultimate control.
And one follow-up, Mr. Chairman. There were four other items that are part of this agenda item. I didn't know if there was anything, Melissa, significant to the other four.
There are, I'm happy to just run through them if that's helpful. There's an electric service charge. There are modifications regarding fraud and non-payment that essentially increase some of the cost recovery that JEA is able to recover for instances involving fraud or theft of utility services. And you'll see that in the red line that you'll receive. Of the tariff document. There's additional streetlight offerings, which when we approved the streetlight tariff changes about 2 years ago, we had about 17 different light offerings that were included in those tariff changes. There's two more that have been added. They're just two different types of technology that need to be incorporated because they're ones that our customers have asked us to include.
This is for Mr. Burr's Christmas lights every year.
Not Christmas lights, but...
He had one of those amps.
Just administrative changes again around fire protection, and this is aligning our tariff language with the current rules and regulations around fire protection.
Okay, great. Thank you.
Other comments, questions? Thank you, Melissa. We need to vote, right? We need to vote to call a hearing, right?
Correct.
Okay. We have a motion. All in favor, say aye.
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 Opposed? No. We passed the motion to call a hearing. What do we do now? Call a hearing for the next meeting, Paul?
No, the motion, yeah, we called the date. It's the next board meeting.
Next
board meeting, yes.
Okay, so everybody with great ideas like apps, see Melissa. Next, we have 3C, open discussion. Any open items that anybody wants to think about or talk about that we don't have on the agenda or not left in the agenda before we start our report with Ms. Kessler? Nothing? Kessler is ready for the Compensation Committee report. Lars?
Oh, thank you. As you know, at the last meeting, first of all, I'd like to ask Angie Hires to please join us at the table. She's a big part of this, and we might need to ask her a question. And we already have counsel here, so I know we got all our support. As you know, at the last meeting, we left a couple of items hanging open for going back and reviewing in the committee. And this wraps up our 2016 comp plan for our CEO. And if you flip over to, the board would flip over to section 4, 2A2, and this is the weighting chart. When we discuss this, now the committee is composed of Chairman Petway, Kelly Flanagan, myself, and of course, Ms. Hires is our staff expert and guide, and with making sure we stay within the guidelines of what we should be doing, it's our counsel, Ms. Brooks. So we looked at and listened to the suggestions you made at the last meeting about the 2017 CEO goals and the weighting on those particular goals. You made some very good recommendations because they were all basically the same. We went back and adjusted them, and I'm sure you've looked at them from your board book. I think we took every recommendation that you made and put it into there. We moved a couple of things in that we broke down the residential and the commercial under our rankings for valuation, but we moved up where we thought the emphasis should be from a CEO perspective, and one, of course, was the utility reliability, which we knew was going to be a focus, and that moved up to 3.50%. And let's see, the other one that we moved up was implement the sewer system framework, and we moved that up to a 3%. But because we knew after the storm, because this obviously just applies to our next year, we had some work to do in that area, and we wanted to make sure the CEO was focusing on that with the right perspective. Any questions about how we took your recommendations and incorporated them? Okay. And this is an action item, and it, even though we approved the plan, we do have to approve the changing of these weightings. So, Mr. Chairman, we need
approval.
Second.
Have a motion and second. Is there further discussion? All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed, like sign.
Thank you.
We appreciate the motion.
Thank you. We appreciate that. The next item you see is the performance management and pay practices. When we look back at how long it had been since we had really done a comprehensive study on our pay practices, we found that it had been a while, and obviously this is an evolving area, just like everything else is within our business. So we thought this doesn't affect the plan we just voted on, 2017, but this is looking forward at 2018. We thought it was time to look for some outside resources that made sure that we were in the proper place, position, and focusing on what are current best practices and what is being utilized in our peer group, and then weigh it against what we're currently doing to see if we make any changes or adjustments before next year. We will not have to bring it to the board for a vote until in the fall, because this will obviously affect the 2018 numbers. But we wanted to let you know that we are looking for some outside resources that can give us some guidance to make sure we're focusing on the correct peer group and the most current, and looking at ways that we can improve and focus on where we want our pay practices to be ongoing. Any questions? Okay. That concludes my report.
Thank you. Mm-hmm. To say we had a spirited discussion on pay for performance would be an understatement of the day. Your chairman has a headache for about 45 days a year when we get in that season. So we're working on trying to figure out some other good, better way to deal with that. And I'm sure Dolores and her wisdom can
We're gonna bring some things to you to look at, and they saw a side of me at one of the meetings that they had never seen before. They said, "Okay, now let's do this a different way." So rather than have me go through that again and use language that they had never heard a lady use, then we're going to do some outside resource work on that. So thank you. Committee did very good work, Mr. Bailey.
Well done. Other new business? Announcements? Any announcements from anyone? Managing Director, CEO's report. Mr. Paul McElroy.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. A couple of things I'd like to report on. In terms of the utilities or JEA's reporting of SSOs and spills, I just wanted to get some clarity here for the members. Prior to the hurricane and prior to the governor's order on reporting pollution events, we had reported to FDEP every spill that affected a water of the U.S. So if we had any type of spill that hit a water body, we reported to FDEP. We reported any spill that was over 1,000 gallons to FDEP immediately. This was within 24 hours. And or any spill of any magnitude that posed a public health matter. And so those items were reported within 24 hours to FDEP. FDEP then, as the third party, would make the evaluation and the assessment, which we think is a good thing in terms of having a third party make the evaluation and the assessment as to what level and what action should be taken. We also accumulated a report and a record of items that were less than 1,000 gallons that did not pose a threat. And these were reported in report format to FDEP on a quarterly basis. And then items that we did within our own control of less than 50 gallons of spill were just kept within the utility. We cleaned up, as we have indicated. In, I guess, late September, executive order came out, which ultimately became a regulation, FDEP, that any and all spills of any size had to go through a reporting mechanism. Which did not relieve any of the reporting that we already had with FDEP, but broadened the report to any amount, as little as a gallon, regardless of public health, regardless of whether it escaped our territory or not, was to be reported to elected officials, the media, and others. And so we had a number of reports, and you'll recall getting the emails over the last period of time. I believe that we were the exception to the rule in terms of the number of reports that we issued versus what others did. Shortly before the holidays, or at the end of the holidays, the administrative judge ruled on the final ruling FDEP and indicated that they were not constitutionally authorized to make that type of ruling, and thus the requirement upon utilities and those that handle pollutants was null and void, and we referred back to the original methodology of reporting. And so what we did was think about this change has brought to light an opportunity for us to be more transparent and to report out in a broader basis than we were before this discussion occurred. So what we're doing right now is complying with FDEP. We've worked with the agency and made sure that we didn't, before we made any change, we talked to our friends at FDEP, and they're comfortable with us. We'll continue to report to FDEP on any waters of the U.S. spill, as was previously required, as well as the 1,000-gallon posing a health issue and or any amount posing a health issue. We'll continue to capture the report of the 1,000 to 50 gallons on a quarterly basis and list out those less than that. We will take any and all of those items down, post those on our website. And we will post those on our website in the same time frame that we report to FDEP. So in a way, I think we end up a little bit with the best of both worlds. We're being fully transparent by posting events at the time we report to FDEP. We have a third-party independent evaluator of the potential public health issue related to any spill, making the evaluation and recommending action or enforcing action upon us to ensure that the public safety is number one. So I think we ended up in a good place. It ended up being fairly confusing in terms of how it was implemented. It was on again, off again. But if we forget the intermediate period, we had a reporting methodology. We're back to that reporting methodology. But we've taken the decision to ensure that we post those in connection with the same reporting timelines we have with FDEP on our website to make it available to the public, which is more than A required and more than we believe anybody else has committed to do in the state. So unless there's any questions, I'll go on. Solar, I provided some information, and we had remarks earlier. We'll continue to work on that. We do have a decision in terms of there was a certain amount of capacity for rooftop and other distributed generated solar installations on our customer side of the meter. We think we're going to probably hit that midsummer, thus, in my earlier comments, a decision to the board before that point in time, before we get to that level of reaching what a prior board had established as a maximum allowable amount in that bucket in under those rate conditions. But we'll go through the whole discussion with the industry to get us to hopefully a good point. In terms of, I'm really proud of our guys. It was sort of under the radar. There was a terrible tornado up in the Albany, Georgia area, and we had a call for mutual aid. And you recall when we had the hurricane, we had hundreds of folks here to help us, but we sent 8 crews up to Albany, Georgia, and they were up there for a week to 10 days and had a great, really had a significant impact in bringing that community back. You know, sometimes it's really interesting to watch the media reaction in other communities, and we got a little video of that the team circulated around, and the local electronic media had really covered a pep rally. The community had the high school cheer squad and band there for all the linemen as they were pulling in and out in the morning and breakfast, and it was a community celebration. So our guys felt great, as well as making a few extra bucks in overtime. J.D. Power was covered, and I think we got it. Do we have everybody's signature before we let everybody go?
Everybody that chairs.
Okay, we can hold the chair. That's my report, Mr. Chairman. Thank you. Thank you.
He's not allowed to leave.
All right.
Questions of our CEO? I have a comment or two on the chair's report before we adjourn. We have two committees that are functioning actively right now. One's nominating committee. As you know, we are on schedule for a slate of officers at the next meeting to be elected for the March meeting. A new slate of officers for the board to select. We're trying diligently to have our second meeting. So if anybody has any input, we still have it. We still haven't made a decision. We're going to have a meeting in February. The other committee that we have that's working on a project is our government affairs committee that I asked to work on our building project here. This building, and we are in process of continuing the long process that originated in September of 2015 that we inherited September 2016 last year. The JE headquarters study. If anybody has any strong feelings about this, I'd like to either hear them today or send them up to Paul. The debate or the question is whether we can have a remodeling of this facility or build a facility somewhere, and what are the next steps? And we're well down that the JEA. Management is well down that path, and I don't want anybody to be caught by surprise when we get ready to make a decision on that. I'd like for everybody to feel like they were up to speed on what's going on and what the best course of action. We definitely need to do something. I think we've had those discussions, and unless you're a brand new board member, you've had some input from various and sundry places. So that's kind of an open item that we don't have an opportunity to talk about. because we don't have an opportunity to talk other than when we meet here or in committee meetings. But that's something that's on my mind that I want to keep the pressure on to continue to move down the road. Paul, you have anything else?
No, sir.
If we don't have anything else, I'd like to announce the next board meeting, third Tuesday of February, and I think that's February 21st, 12 o'clock. And Finance and Audit Committee meets March 13th. Nominating Committee, Compensation Committee, and Government Affairs to be determined. If there's nothing else, we'll stand adjourned. Thank you.
Thank you.